Hey everyone, welcome back to Seeker Plus and our series on the Metaverse. If you missed episode one that lays out exactly what the Metaverse is, sort of, I'd say go back and watch that because otherwise this episode isn't going to make a lot of sense. I'm going to talk about Fortnite. It'll seem like it comes out of nowhere. I promise it's relevant. Anyway, let's jump back into the Metaverse. A lot of pieces required for this massive undertaking are already in place today. Take VR headsets, for example. They're at a place where they can render scenes now at high enough resolution and frame rate that they don't cause motion sickness. At least, not for most people. Some don't even need to be plugged into PC graphics cards to work. Facebook's Quest 2 uses a chip similar to what you might find in a smartphone. Even smartphones could work, though dedicated headsets often have handheld hardware for interacting with virtual objects, but hand tracking does exist. There are some foot tracking controllers, but they're not super common yet, so most VR avatars are just floating legless torsos, and it's kind of immersion breaking. Avatars also tend to be more on the cartoonish side. If people want more true-to-life looking ones, there are some technical barriers that developers are working to overcome. Human touches, like matching lip syncing and appropriate facial expressions, can be the difference between having a pleasant VR chat with a good friend
and talking to a soulless inhuman imposter.
So companies are working on headsets with more sensors to track your face movements, or AI algorithms that can take speech and convert it to 3D facial animation. Full disclosure, I should mention at this point, I also work for NVIDIA, a company that is working on metaverse technologies like this sort of AI. The biggest question mark that's looming over everything is how it's all going to work together. What standards and protocols will everyone universally adopt that makes everything run smoothly? This was a key part of getting the World Wide Web to work. Everyone adopted HTML that browsers can all use to decipher websites, standardized IP addresses tell computers where to send data, a domain name system assigns IP addresses to URLs that are easier for users to remember. In the early days of the internet, all of this had to be sorted out, and it was a chaotic process. Most of us didn't see it unfold, though, because the first internet users were academics who were just looking for a way to share research and send messages. Nobody tried to make their proprietary technology the key to the whole thing. In fact, the creator of HTML, a computer scientist based at CERN named Tim Berners-Lee, believed that making his creation free to everyone was the key to a truly worldwide network. It wasn't until after the groundwork was established that private companies realized, hey, this internet thing could catch on. With the metaverse, companies are seeing an opportunity to make themselves essential for the next internet. A heavyweight title fight is brewing between some of the biggest names in tech, and each has their strengths. Facebook, Meta, has an enormous user base, and if they can convince them that the metaverse is A, worth partaking in, and B, best experienced in VR, their ownership of Oculus will be a huge advantage. Epic Games not only has Fortnite, which we established is nearly a metaverse already, they also made the game engine Fortnite was built in, Unreal. Unreal is free for developers to download and work in, Epic just takes a cut when the game sells. Because of this, it's become massively widespread. It's even found users in the film industry. The Mandalorian was rendered with Unreal Engine, and it was used on set in real time for framing shots and placing actors. That could set up Epic in a great spot to establish their software as a key piece that enables interoperability. Google has experience making augmented reality glasses and wearables, the company has mapped entire cities, which could be useful for making digital replicas, and their Android operating system is the most widespread in the world. Amazon's Prime to send people physical goods they might buy in the virtual world, yes, that pun was intended. Microsoft has their mixed reality HoloLens headset and an established business software suite, and Apple has their mobile devices and wearables and the App Store. So, who's to say who, if anyone, will come out ahead? This could go any number of ways, and some unknown dark horse could end up being the savviest operator or breakthrough innovator. Some developers don't like the idea of a large company controlling too much, so they've created a decentralized digital world appropriately called Decentraland. But whether or not that becomes the dominant thing, I don't know. If I had to bet, though, I think the most likely outcome is some of these big tech companies will get a big slice of the pie, but they'll still have to cooperate with each other in the end. NVIDIA has developed something they call Omniverse, which allows proprietary programs to talk to each other. This lets 3D designers collaborate in real time when they build a virtual world. It's easy to see how something like that could be the interstitial glue that's holding the component parts of the metaverse together. Interoperability is a huge technical challenge, but it's also a big design problem too. Let's say you're in one part of the metaverse, you're playing a single-player game, and you unlock a shiny new weapon. Let's call it a Technoblade 9000. And you're just mowing down mobs of AI-controlled enemies with this thing. If there were no limits on interoperability, you'd be able to take it to another game world, like a multiplayer game. Here's the thing, though. Game devs spend tons of time trying to balance weapons, so no single one becomes a must-pick or dominates the game. If just anyone can show up all of a sudden with a Technoblade 9000, they could ruin the experience for everyone else. This is already an issue today. Call of Duty is such a big IP that multiple developers work on different offshoots of the franchise. In 2020, the series introduced a Battle Royale mode, and later that year, the mode incorporated a bunch of weapons from another Call of Duty game, a couple of which were way overpowered. Basically, if you wanted to win, you had to use these two guns, and the game got stale and frustrating. To add to the confusion, both games had different versions of weapons with the same name. Keep in mind, these problems came from mixing two slightly different games. Can you imagine what would happen if you could literally show up to a sword fight with a gun? Or a tank? So, maybe there should be limits on items players can bring from one part of the world to another, but what about cosmetic items? Well, that might be more of a gray area. Some cosmetics in games can give players a competitive advantage. Again, my mind goes to Call of Duty when players could unlock a skin that covered them completely in a solid shade of black. A lot of players took advantage of this by hiding in dark corners and pouncing on enemies who couldn't see them. If it wasn't clear, I feel like I've been personally victimized by Call of Duty. Now, there might be other ways that total interoperability might be an issue in the world. Who's to say exactly how bringing whatever you want from one place to anywhere else is going to be an issue, but I'm sure people will figure out creative ways to be terrible on the internet. But let's imagine all of these issues are solved. We build a network infrastructure that can handle limitless people in a shared world at once. All the code and hardware works together seamlessly, and we've struck a nice balance on what's allowed anywhere and what's kept in certain fenced-off areas. What will the world look like at that point? How will the metaverse change things for the better? And how will it change them for the worse? We'll cover that in our next episode. If you like this one, YouTube has an incredible new button that heightens immersion by allowing you to click like, which will let me know that you liked it. They've also made a subscribe button. I'm sure I'm the first person ever telling you about this. So now that we're 2/3 of the way through our metaverse series, what are your thoughts so far? How do you feel about the role that big tech is likely going to play in its development? Let us know in the comments, which is another innovative new feature that draws you into this shared world of online video. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you for episode 3.